Hi, I'm Robin Whalley, welcome to Lenscraft. Today I'm looking at customising the studio panel layout in Affinity Photo, and I'll also explain how to use the new studio preset feature. Most people don't seem to give much thought to their interface layout in Affinity Photo. Many assume their layout is the default and everyone else's looks the same. In fact, I often receive emails from people struggling to make sense of Affinity Photo because their screen doesn't match a video or a tutorial. There are lots of reasons this can happen, so this video is a crash course in customising and organising the studio panels in Affinity Photo. After all, studio panels probably make up 80% of the layout. I'd also encourage you to watch the entire video because I throw in lots of information throughout. When you understand this video, you'll immediately feel more confident using Affinity Photo for editing. Let's start by looking at a single studio panel. The Navigator Studio panel is a good example to use because it's quite simple. At the top, we have a zoom control to set the image magnification for the main preview. When the preview spills over the edges of the screen, a movable window appears in the Navigator. We can use this to navigate around the image by dragging it with our mouse. Then, at the bottom, we can define a series of viewpoints which then appear in a drop-down list. At this point, you might be thinking, I don't have a viewpoint drop-down. If you don't, you can make it visible by selecting the Advanced option in the Studio Panels menu in the top right. A lot of the Studio Panels have an Advanced view which reveals more tools. What we have in the Navigator then is a series of related tools to navigate our images and which Affinity pulls together into a single Studio Panel. And it's the same with the other Studio Panels. They consolidate tools together that are used for a related purpose. For example, the Layer Studio panel has lots of tools. Many of these are available in pop-up menus or are displayed as icons, but they all relate to working with layers. The next thing that you probably already realise is that not all of the available Studio panels are visible. If they were, the interface would become very crowded and confusing. When we look in the View menu and select Studio, we see a list of the available Studio panels. The ones with a tick mark next to them are currently visible in the interface. When I click the Navigator panel in the menu, it toggles the visibility off to hide it. I can then select it again to redisplay it and it appears in its original position. You should also realise that different personas have different studio panels. If I switch to the Export persona and select the Studio menu, there are less panels available than in the Photo persona. Whilst there are some panels like the Navigator panel that you'll find in other personas, a panel like Slices is only available in the Export persona. Let's go back to the Photo persona now to look at arranging the studio panels. As you can see, the panels are in groups and appear as a series of tabs which you can select by clicking with your mouse. You can also change the order of these tabs by clicking and dragging them with your mouse. It's even possible to click and drag the panels to different groups. If I click and drag the Navigator panel, I can move it into the same group as the Layers panel. But I can also drag it out of the groups and have it as a free-floating window. If you're working on a large screen, you might want to have a panel as a floating window. You can then move the panel to near the area you're working on, so there's less movement when you want to select other tools. This is especially useful when you're using a graphics tablet where you need to move the pen much more than you would a mouse. Currently, the panels are organised into three groups on the right of the interface. What you may not realise is that you can create additional groups. Watch what happens when I drag the panel to a new position in the right-hand studio area of the interface. The area becomes highlighted as a blue rectangle. When I release the mouse, it creates a new studio panel grouping. Something that I didn't mention earlier when I showed you the floating panel was that it wasn't just a single panel. It's really a group where you can dock multiple panels to save screen space. I can now dock this floating group into the new group I created in the right studio area. Whilst you've been watching this, you may have noticed that I've been referring to this area as the right studio. Well, there's also a left studio as well, but you can't see it at the moment because none of the panels are visible. If I use the View Studio menu to make the macros panel visible, the left studio area also becomes visible. You can also see the options to show the left and right studios are now ticked in the bottom of the Studios menu. As with the Studios panel, you can click these to toggle the areas off and on. If I click the option to show the right studio panel when it has a tick mark next to it, it hides all the studio panels on the right. When I click it again, the right studio becomes visible and we can see all the panels again. Notice that when the studio became visible again, all the same panels are displayed as before. Now if I remove a panel to make it float before I hide the studio area, the floating panel isn't hidden because it's not part of that studio area. It's only the panels in the studio area that are hidden. There's also another option in the menu that you can use to hide or show both studio panels together. Before I click this, notice that I've assigned a shortcut key to the menu option. By default, this menu option doesn't have a shortcut, but you can define your own as well as changing others. I find it helpful to use the keyboard to toggle this option rather than keep moving my mouse. If you want to create your own shortcuts, use the Shortcuts page in the Affinity Preferences. Given all this flexibility, it's not unusual for people to change their interface without realising it or to forget they've changed something. If you find you get into a mess, use the Reset option at the bottom of the Studio menu to get back to the default layout. This produces the default arrangement of the studio panels when you first install Affinity. Unfortunately, it's not the arrangement I started with. For that, I need to use one of the new features released in Affinity Photo 1.9, which is the studio presets. It's now possible to save an arrangement of studio panels as a preset so you can easily return to that layout. Just use the option in the menu to add the preset and then enter the preset name in the dialog. You can see in the Studio Presets Manager that I've already saved a preset before I started this video. When I select that, it adjusts my layout. If you find yourself needing to delete or rename a preset, use the Studio Presets Manager. I'm going to wrap up the video here, but there are other things you can do to customize the Affinity Photo interface. I've already mentioned setting up custom shortcuts, but you can also configure your tools and toolbars. If you want to know more, please see my book Affinity Photo How To, which explains these and a lot more about using Affinity Photo. I hope you found today's video helpful. I'm Robin Whalley, you've been watching Lenscraft. I'll see you soon for another video.